when I came to Beth Abraham, it was with the sense that there was already some understanding of what music therapy was. And sure enough, within my first week of being there, I get a manila envelope in the interoffice mail with a torn off piece of loose leaf paper. And on that loose leaf paper scribbled, every disease is a musical problem, every cure a musical solution, Novalis, welcome Ollie. And I went to my super, who is Ollie? Who's this person? Like, and she goes, well, he's this quirky neurologist who's there, and he does these really great notes and stuff. And so I wanted to meet him. I didn't know that he was face, you know, had visual agnosia for faces. So I would walk by him every day. He didn't know who I was. And then finally I had the opportunity one day early on when one of my patients, my dementia patients, was sitting outside his door for their monthly evaluation. And I stood there waiting for him to come. And I said, hi, Dr. Sachs, thank you for your note. I'm Connie, the new music therapist. And he got all excited. And I said, this is one, I've been working with Mrs. Smith, and, you know, not her name, but, you know. And he says, oh, he goes, does she respond to music? And I said, absolutely, that's why I'm here, I want to show you. And he goes, okay, come in. And I go into his office, and he goes, well, let me show you how I assess my patients. So he sat in front of her, and he took it really gently, I mean, so beautifully, sitting in front of her face to face, holding her hands, and rocking with her and singing, Daisy, Daisy. And she was nodding her head and smiling and just responding. And he said, see how she responds. And I was looking and I said, well, was she responding to the music or was she responding to him rocking with her? And I said, well, excuse me, Dr. Sachs, but when I work with her, she sings. And he goes, she does. Well, show me. Come in. He moved out of his chair. And he goes, please, you know, sit down, show me what you do. And then I started singing an old gospel church song with her. And she was African-American, and she was blind and very contracted. And I didn't take her arms per se, but I just looked her, you know, in the face because she was blind. And I just started singing very slowly the spiritual, and she straightened up. And she started singing full force. He takes a step back, and then she started talking. And at that point, he was able to ask her questions. And he goes, this is amazing. He goes, we have to talk. And so that started a lifelong, 35 years plus relationship of us asking questions with each other. He had already really experienced the ability of rhythm to animate. And he really, his focus was really on what it was about rhythm that would allow somebody with a Parkinsonian type movement disorder be able to move so fluidly, be able to sing when they had aphasia. And he had never really had a chance to work closely with people with Alzheimer's disease and dementia because his focus had been more on the people with the movement disorders. And here I was showing him this new possibility. And so we spent, and we live very close together, so we would spend evenings just asking questions. And then what happened was when he became, when, you know, he was trying to publish these case studies, which really weren't taking off, but then would eventually got into the New York Review of Books, and he was starting to get known with not only Awakenings, but the Man Who Mistook His Wife for a Hat. So he had two wonderful successes in the late 80s, early 90s. And at that same time, I was just finishing my tenure as president of the American Music Therapy Association. So just prior to that, I used to literally drag him to music therapy conferences, brought him up to Boston one time, which I know Donna and Cheryl and others remember quite amazingly, the time he spoke at the Boston conference, and was desperate to introduce this man to the field of music therapy, not only to introduce him, because he already bought in, I mean, he already was fully excited about the hope of music therapy and the promise of music therapy, but I wanted music therapists to hear him and to hear his understanding about how music reaches the brains of people who can't function otherwise. And he was invited to speak in Washington for when the Older Americans Act was up for revision, and he spoke at the conference in Canada that was in the NAMT, AAMT, and Canadian. At that point, his speaking about music became something that people started to know of him. And he started becoming a medical doctor, neurologist, who was a face for music therapists and an advocate for music therapy.